Backstage Special. He came out of the West in 1964, leading a band of cosmic weirdos in a frontal assault on the musical sensibilities of the civilized world. And when the smoke had cleared, the battlefield was strewn with over 20 albums, and victory was his. The enemy had been Frank Zappa.
When we first started off, the whole concept of rock and roll, the way the American public understood it, was oriented towards pretty boys strumming nice chords on guitars, singing in a high voice, and prancing a little bit, and doing lyrics about boy-girl situations that really mattered and hurt your heart. So here I was, not too attractive, with some other people equally unattractive, wishing to make a career in the rock and roll industry. Well, what could be more absurd than us going out prancing a little bit and singing those same kind of songs? Well, that just obviously wouldn't get it. However, there was a market out there somewhere for people who liked monsters and ugliness. And those were our first fans, you know.
Frank Zappa joined a band called the Soul Giants. Shortly thereafter, he gained control and renamed them the Mothers. From the start, these boys were different, both in the way they played and in the way they looked.
If you don't look the way people want you to look, then you have a problem being the way people want you to be, you see. And everybody wants you to be something. I mean, that applies to all fields besides entertainment. You know, if you're a busboy, you better look like a busboy. You can't come in there looking like a playboy if you're a busboy. And if you're a playboy, you can't look like a busboy, because then the rest of the people on the jet won't like you. You know, so everybody has a certain amount of packaging inflicted upon him based on the type of enterprise he's engaged in. See, that's just one of the facts of sociology. That's the way it works.
The mystery man came over and he said, "I'm out of sight."
Poncho, or is that a Sears poncho? Don't you know you could make more money as a butcher? So don't you waste your time on me.
I think that just about everybody has some sort of creative streak in them and can find some medium by which to express themselves. What makes the difference between what a performer does and what a private individual does is one guy decided he was going to go public, and he was going to, he had to take that drastic step one day and start inflicting his art on other people. And at the point where you inflict it for the first time, you get some sort of feedback as to whether or not there is a sympathetic vibe for what you do somewhere out there in the universe. And if somebody comes up to you and says, "Hey, why don't you keep doing that?" and you keep doing it, well, then you're liable to go public, and the next thing you know, you'll be a performer. Or if somebody looks at you and says, "Gosh, what you do is the pits, why don't you stop?" then if somebody says that to you and you keep on doing it, you're liable to become even better. That's what I did.
Give me your dirty love, like you might surrender to some dragon in your dreams. Give me your dirty love.
That dirty love. That dirty love.
The brutal bites.
Come on, French.
The brutal chooses
snap.
The brutal bites.
Come on, French.
The brutal chooses
snap.
Overnight sensation. Cosmic debris from Apostrophe, Frank Zappa's only top 10 record, and from Hot Rats, Peaches and Regalia.
The special with Jimmy Roach will return after this message.
63. If you played in a band and wanted to get them recorded, all you had to do was go to Cucamonga, California, the home of Studio Z. Upon arrival, you'd plunk down $13.50 for the first hour, and the proprietor, Frank Zappa, would start rolling the tapes. Since then, Frank has done such diverse things as conduct the L.A. Symphony Orchestra, produce a movie, spend 9 months in a wheelchair after being pushed off stage, and host Saturday Night Live. But through it all, he's remained clear about his true musical purpose.
I was filling in blanks left by other people who were functioning in the media. I thought that I provided a useful alternative to the love song syndrome. Filled in a lot of blanks in that mysterious area somewhere between the love song and the march. And so that's basically the realm that I function in, you know, and I try and cover that pretty completely. That's my beat.
Dreamed I was an Eskimo. Frozen wind began to blow. Nanook. The only way you can get it fixed up is to go trudging across the tundra. Mile after mile, merging across the tundra, right down to the parish of St. Alfonso.
This whole business is a process of decorating time. See, I decorate time for other people, and in the process, I decorate time for my own amusement. So I just go around decorating pieces of time with physical activity, notes, agitated air, and things like that.
Ripped My Flesh, and a couple of tunes from Apostrophe, Frank Zappa.
Jimmy Roach will be back with the special right after this.
Mothers have involved over 100 musicians, among them Howard Kalin and Mark Volman, former members of the Turtles. For each of them, there was a long period of adjustment as they came to understand the complexities of Frank's music.
I think it's different for every group. If you're talking specifically about the Mothers, I would say that no matter who I put into the group, it takes at least a year before they find out what they're doing there. Because what we're doing is so different from any kind of musical experience that the members might have had working with any other kind of group. No matter how professional they are, no matter how much touring they've done, what style music they've been playing before, once they come into this group, it's a completely different world. And they don't find out about it until they've been doing it for about a year. And then all of a sudden, it just snaps, you know, like with that group with Mark and Howard, it snapped at a concert in Beloit, Wisconsin, in a gymnasium, just right in the middle of the show. It seemed like the guys finally realized what I was trying to get them to do out there on stage, and from then on, it was a different world.
Say! Imagine you, I do, I think about you day and night, it's only right to think about the girl you love. I know the time, so happy together. You pass the call on, invest the time, and you say you belong to me. And ease my mind, imagine how the world could be. So near and far, so happy together.
So sitting in this room writing music, I'm a very boring person. I don't think there's anybody in my audience would want to spend more than 2 minutes while I'm sitting in here doing what I'm doing and being what I am when I'm not on stage. I think that my existence other than on the stage has little or no relevance to the American public or anybody else at large. You know, they don't need to know who I am or what I do. They don't want to know. It's of no use to them. If I'm on stage and I'm jumping around and I'm a lunatic and I'm playing the guitar and doing all that stuff, then it's useful to those people because they come there to see me do that kind of stuff. And when I'm out there doing it, that's me. I am that Frank Zappa that's on the stage. There's no fake about it. I'm really that crazy, you know, but only when I'm on the stage. And if somebody has to do an interview with me, if they interview me at a show, at a time when I am crazy, then that's the person that I am. But here you are, you came to my room. I've been sitting here writing music since 6 o'clock in the morning. I'm a bum.
I might be moving to Montana soon. Just to raise me up a crop of demo cloth.
Montana from Overnight Sensation and Happy Together, recorded live at the Fillmore East in June of 1971.
The special with Jimmy Roach will return shortly.
The first five Zappa albums were released on MGM Records and have become collector's items. It was also MGM that began calling Frank's band the Mothers of Invention because they were scared of having a group called simply the Mothers. Those first efforts were tremendously intricate, involved albums, full of songs whose sarcasm demanded the listener's full attention.
Well, there are some people who are struggling in the area of worrying about their body smells and all those other terrible things that the Madison Avenue psychologists are trying to warp you with, you know. My view of it is that if it'll make you laugh, it's good for you. Or if it'll make you horny, it's good for you. Or anybody who does not commit suicide is an optimist.
Motherly love. Forget about the brotherly and motherly love. Motherly love is just a thing for you. You know your mother's going to love you, honey. You know it doesn't bother me at all that you're only 18 years old, because I got a little motherly love for you, baby.
And not all of Frank's music is experimental. Some of his best material has consisted of authentic recreations of the music of the late 50s. When the Mothers released the album Cruisin' with Reuben and the Jets, a lot of folks thought that it was a legitimate oldies band, not realizing that in reality, Reuben was the notorious Zappa.
Well, that's happened a lot of times with us, you know. Some of our work has been so extremely subtle as to have been mistaken for the real thing.
If you decide to leave me, it's all over. If you decide to leave me, it's all over.
Unfortunate victims of lies you believe, a plague upon your ignorance that keeps the young from the truth they deserve.
Some classic Zappa, Harry, You're a Beast, and What's the Ugliest Part of Your Body, from the 1967 album We're Only in It for the Money. Stuff Up the Cracks is from Reuben and the Jets, and Motherly Love from Freak Out.
We'll be back in a moment with Jimmy Roach and the special.
The music of the past 10 years has been rather predictable. Of course, there's nothing wrong with predictability, but it's always good to keep someone around in the closet who can balance that out. Someone whose music can provoke a little mental stimulation. That's the job of Frank Zappa.
Well, I think it's helped all the way around. It kept me busy, you know, kept me off the street and took me off the street and onto the road. And for the people who are listening to the records, you know, the lonely little unusual person in the small town who didn't have anything to relate to. One day there was an album called Freak Out sitting on a shelf in a store, and by accident that lonely, misunderstood, misfit person took that album and went, wait a minute, There's another one out there someplace just like me. Crazy. Deranged. He'll help me. And so, later, when more of those albums came out, these weird people took heart.
The Muffin Man is seated at the table in the laboratory of the Utility Muffin Research Kitchen. Reaching for an oversized chrome spoon, he gathers an intimate quantity of dried muffin remnants. And brushing his scapular aside, proceeds to dump these inside of his shirt. Bruce Fowler on trombone, Napoleon Murphy Brock on tenor sax and lead vocals, Terry Bozio on drums, Tom Fowler on bass, Denny Wally on slide, George Duke on keyboards, Captain Beefheart on vocals and soprano sax and madness. Thank you very much for coming to the concert tonight. Hope you enjoyed it. Good night, Austin, Texas, wherever you are.
Tonight's special was produced by Dennis Benson, Ted Rossetti, and Jack Shortlidge. My thanks to them, to Frank Zappa, and to you. I'm Jimmy Roach. Good night.